qualifications that are required for people to run our clinics. Our spine care clinics, the one in the Mahalapa District Hospital is kind of primary care, kind of tertiary care, but the one in Shoshone is true primary care, and that's what we're trying to develop, is a model of care, true primary spine care. Can you guys hear me all right? So that's what we're developing. And what we're trying to create are primary spine care specialists. So they can be either PTs or chiropractors. It doesn't matter what the background is. What matters is the qualifications that people have. They have to be able to diagnose because it's primary contact. They have to be able to read x-rays and other imaging, as it seems is now a big part of it. And they also need to be licensed to perform manipulation. And as you can see, it's one of the most significant interventions for the management of spinal pain is manipulation. So those are really the three big qualifications. I have PTs and chiros because they're the most likely, but it could also include medical doctors who have training and experience in manual medicine and actually performing manipulation and other therapeutic interventions, manual interventions. So as you've heard already, the first goal is to really rule out serious pathology. To make sure that this is just a musculoskeletal issue. So far, in both clinics, we've seen 350 patients, and we've rendered about 2,600 treatments. We found 19 patients with serious pathologies, and they've included things like cervical fracture, compression fractures, TB, scoliosis, disc, which you heard about earlier, stenosis, congenital deformities, and a host of other major pathologies. So we heard about the scoliosis screening program. This is one of the patients we have at the Mahalapa District Hospital. We're going to be following and monitoring those patients for progress, deformity, possibly referring them for bracing, and maybe indications for surgery, which Dr. Asaragu is going to be talking to you about in a little bit. The second goal is to rule out neurological deficits originating from the spine, and that includes radiculopathy and myelopathy. Interesting thing is, of all the cases that we've seen, we've only seen one case of radiculopathy, a cervical radiculopathy secondary to stenosis. We've had lots of patients coming in with radiating pain, but as you'll see later in the talk, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's a radiculopathy. Those patients are going to be referred for imaging and possibly other management. And then again, the indications for surgery is going to be Dr. Henry, you'll be talking about indications for surgery. So, but the majority of the cases that we're treating, almost 90% have presented without red flags or neurological deficits. So really the majority of the cases that we're treating are pain originating from myofascial origin. And I'll get into that a little bit. In our examination, we're going to look at range of motion, either gross range of motion of the spine, segmental range of motion of the spine, range of motion of the hips. This is something that's very unique to Africa. This woman is over 90 years old, and she has that sort of hamstring flexibility. It's amazing here, the hamstring flexibility of the woman. We look to do soft tissue examination. We're going to look for spasming in the soft tissue, restrictions, fibrosis, or tenderness in those tissues. We're going to look at psychosocial risk factors, which Dr. Nardin has mentioned earlier. We're going to look at lifestyle and exercise and see if there are any risk factors within that. So now what I want to do is talk a little bit. This is a little bit more to somebody. You guys recognize anybody?
No.
This is why women have more back pain than men. So the mechanism, I want to talk about soft tissue, and this is more appealing to the physiotherapists, occupational therapists who are dealing with this type of injury all the time. And in order to understand how to treat soft tissue injury, it's important to understand the mechanisms of injuries of the soft tissue. So the first type of injury is an acute injury. Everybody's familiar with that, but what you may not be familiar with is it has to be a major traumatic event for it to be a true acute injury. There has to be a motor vehicle accident, a fall from a height, something, a fairly large traumatic event. And when that occurs, there are the four cardinal signs of inflammation: heat, redness, pain, and swelling. Okay? And as that inflammation settles down, the repair process continues. What is left behind is that repair tissue or the fibrosis. Okay? And you'll often get a stiff joint, like, let's take, say, an ankle sprain. You're going to be left behind with some stiffness. That stiffness, the tissue may remodel over time. It may not. It may continue to cause restrictions and pain, or it may heal normally. But, excuse me. Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's great.
So that's an acute injury. Actually, I'm going to backtrack a little bit because what I'm presenting is a bit of a theoretical model. It's the best model we have with the available evidence that we have for soft tissue injury. So the second type of injury is a repetitive strain injury. Now, instead of a large traumatic event, you have a repetitive motion. And one of the theories is that when a muscle contracts and relaxes very rapidly, there isn't time for that muscle to relax. And so that the muscle can't get enough oxygen and nutrients back in to, for the subsequent contraction. You get a hypoxic state in the tissue, and that hypoxia attracts fibroblasts to deposit the fibrous connective tissue. So over time, what you're getting is a very slow accumulation of bits of fibrous connective tissue that build and build and build and build. So now the patient isn't going to present with a major traumatic event. They're going to present with two things. Either a very slow progressive pain that gets worse and worse and worse. It comes and goes and comes and goes and then starts to stay a little longer and get a little bit worse and becomes chronic and so on. Or what they'll present with is a sudden onset of pain with a minor traumatic event. And when I say minor, it's an event that they've done 1,000 times in their lives. How many times have you heard a patient say, well, I just bent over to pick something up and, oh, there went my back. That's a minor traumatic event, because that person's probably bent over 1,000 times for a lifetime. But why did that particular bend make a difference? And so often a clinician will try to go back and associate that onset of pain with the actual event. But if the onset is a minor one, it's been done a million times, then the process that's probably occurred is that repetitive, slow accumulation of fibrous connective tissue. So it's better to look further back in the history and say, how do you use your body? Because our body does adapt to how we use it. So how are we using it? Is it something repetitive? The other interesting thing about this is the pain will present without the cardinal signs of inflammation. It'll be pain, but there won't be any heat or redness or swelling. You won't feel a bogginess in that tissue. And you'll actually find a sort of ropey fibrotic feeling in that tissue. The third type of injury is a chronic muscle contraction. Again, this is a hypoxic state. The muscle is contracting, so because of the contraction, it needs more blood and nutrients. But with a chronic contraction, you're actually squeezing off the supply of blood, so you get a mismatch between the supply and the demand. Hypoxic state in the tissue, slow accumulation of fibrous connective tissue. Again, this hypoxia theory is a little bit, it's still theoretical, but it does explain what we see in the tissue, what we feel in the tissue, and how the tissue responds to treatment. So again, with a chronic muscle contraction, there's this slow accumulation. Patient will complain about a slow onset of pain. And most of the patients that we see, we ask them, what's the onset? And they'll say, it just came on slowly, or I can't remember how it came on. And then a few will say they had an onset with a sudden event. But the vast majority are saying slow onset. They may complain of when they're standing doing dishes for a long period of time, there's this ache in their low back that gets worse and worse the longer they stand. Those sorts of histories are the things that indicate that it may be this type of a mechanism that is occurring rather than looking for an inflammatory state. So all of these tend to lead to some sort of fibrosis, okay? And again, it's only the acute injury, the true acute major traumatic event that's going to cause the inflammatory process. So how does it actually present? What does the patient tell you about their pain? And what they'll tell you first is there's going to be pain. And almost every patient has walked into our clinic, and almost every patient that ever walked into my practice in Ottawa came in with pain. That's what they come to us for. There may be a restricted motion in the tissues or around the joints, because if the tissue gets fibrotic and tight, the joint's going to have a restricted range of motion as well. There are going to be tender points. The patient will say, it hurts right here. And one of the major, one of the best questions you can ask is, where is your pain? And it's amazing how many people don't ask, where is your pain? And you ask them to point with one finger, because patients will say, well, my pain's here. Ask them to point, supa kemanuana. Point with one finger, okay? Where is it? And when they point to it, if you put your finger on that point, chances are you can reproduce their pain. Now you know what their chief complaint is. It's that tissue, and it's that simple. The examination is that simple. So you're looking for tender points. Again, there's no inflammation in the majority of these cases. And there's also going to be trigger point referral. So when I was saying we haven't had cases of lumbar radiculopathy, we haven't. We have had pain, lots of patients with pain down the back of their leg. And at last count, there was about 27 different trigger points, sclerotomes, other causes of pain down the back of their leg that were not radiculopathy. So there's lots of things that can cause pain down the back of the leg. And you need to start to tease out, what is that? You want to reproduce the pain when you're in the room with the patient. Does that reproduce the pain? No. Does this trigger point reproduce the pain? So understanding the location of those trigger points and how to actually activate them and get the pain to refer is a little bit of a trick as well. You can't be gentle with a patient and sort of tap lightly and say, well, does this hurt? You really got to get in and dig into those points. And it will reproduce that pain. And you'll see some cases later that refer to that. So the trigger points can refer pain. They can also refer numbness, burning, tingling, and there's no hard neurological signs. There's no actual weakness, actual sensory loss, actual change in reflux. Okay, and that's another good indication that maybe you want to start looking for a trigger point rather than a radiculopathy. Not that all radiculopathies cause hard neurological signs, but if there aren't hard neurological signs, then maybe you want to start looking for other things as well. and they will be reproduced with the palpation of the tissue. I don't like a patient to exit my room until I have reproduced their pain and I am sure, and they tell me with emphatically, with clarity, that that is the pain that they experience. Because if I know that, then I know what I'm dealing with and I know where I want to treat that patient. So now, how does this relate to imaging? Well, the first thing is, for x-ray, MRI, and CT, that people just got first. So, first of all, the majority of findings on x-ray do not correlate with the symptomatology. So, as Dr. Rowe was saying, you really need to correlate what you see on the x-ray with what you see clinically, okay? The second thing is, let me put the last one in, that was supposed to go first. So, soft tissue, this fibrosis that we're talking about, it's not visible on x-ray or MRI or CT. So how many doctors here have had patients who've had chronic low back pain and you've sent them for x-rays and MRIs and CTs and nothing has come up? Show of hands. Okay, it's quite common, would you agree? This type of pain won't show up on that. So when you don't see anything, it's not that they don't have pain and it's some psychological problem. The problem is it's a pain that just doesn't show up. It's this fibrosis. So the majority of findings on x-ray are not related to the presenting pain. But the x-rays are still useful, even if they don't relate to the pain that you're treating, because number one, they may direct treatment. This person has all kinds of degenerative changes. I don't feel the degenerative changes are causing the pain, but those degenerative changes may make me decide not to manipulate or to do some other intervention. So it can direct your treatment to some degree. It doesn't negate treatment, but it can direct your treatment. And the second thing is, it can really help with psychosocial risk factors. As Dr. Nardin was saying, a patient might come in and be catastrophizing or be very pain-focused or feel like their life is falling apart. And to be able to show them an x-ray and say, there's nothing here. Your pain is just soft tissue, and it's only pain. That can go a long way in calming a patient and reducing pain. And sometimes I have seen, certainly back in my practice in Ottawa, where you just sit down and you tell a patient what's going on, and their pain reduces almost 50% just by talking to them. So those psychosocial risk factors are very powerful. And using x-rays and using palpation and talking to people about their pain goes a long way in reassuring them. So how do we treat this? We're getting symptomatic relief through joint manipulation and mobilization, which we saw was a very powerful intervention for spinal disorders. We're going to do the soft tissue mobilization. So if this theory that I just presented is true, then we need to remove that fibrosis. And fibrotic tissue is not going to be removed by light, gentle massage. It needs to be deep, it needs to be aggressive. It often hurts the patient, it usually hurts the patient, but it is very effective, and often patients will stand up after a treatment and be amazed at the difference in the pain sensation. Either it's completely gone or significantly reduced, and they've been living with this for years. So the soft tissue mobilization is a very important intervention part of it. And stretching, home exercises, and when you put all these together, joint mobilization and manipulation, soft tissue mobilization, stretching, home exercises, what we're really trying to do is remobilize tissue that has become immobile. So manipulation is going to get joints moving that aren't moving very well. Soft tissue mobilization is going to get the soft tissue going. The stretching is a very effective preventive tool to prevent that that fibrosis, the process of fibrosis, from accumulating slowly over time. If you're stretching on a regular basis, it just doesn't have time to accumulate. And then the home exercises as well are strengthening, but also maintaining ranges of motion. This is one of the exercise programs that we're about to implement out in Shoshone. We've had it translated into Setswana. And it's a program that's been adopted by the World Health Organization, Bone and Joint Decade, the World Health Day. There's all kinds of provinces in Canada that are using it. A very well accepted program. And we're creating these booklets. This is the front page and the back page, and then the other two sides of the two inside pages. And we'll be taking patients and taking them through that, just to get them moving, just get moving. I always used to say to my patients, motion is lotion. So getting people moving, keeping them moving, getting them, if they're sitting for long periods of time, getting them up out of their chair and getting them moving, it's all really important. Motion is lotion. Also education with patients is one of the interventions, treatments. We want to talk to them about psychosocial risk factors. Your pain is not as bad as you think it is. And explaining to them why they have pain and that it is not a catastrophic problem. It is just pain. Not to minimize the patient's pain, but. And then actual pain management, how they can help gain control of their pain. Having that control, again, is another one of those big psychosocial risk factors that goes a long way. You can actually modify your pain and control your pain in these ways. Posture interventions, lifestyle interventions, whether it be nutritional, lifestyle habits, any ergonomics, depending on what type of work they're doing. This is some of the education that we're passing on to patients. So let me talk about some of the statistics that we've been seeing in the clinics. First of all, in Mahalapi, we've seen 220 patients, 1,570 treatments, 75% female, which fits the statistics that Dr. Holloman gave earlier. Our age range is 6 to 86 years old, with the average age of 44. 5% are farmers, and you're going to see why I have that statistic. 27% have a primary education or lower. The vast majority are higher educated coming into the Mahalapi District Hospital. 63% have low back pain, 89% have some spinal pain, and then 5% are hip, knee, and ankle pain. So we're generally seeing spinal disorders, but we are World Spine Care. So people are really coming to us for the spine. 75% of the patients have had their pain greater than a year. 87% have had had pain greater than 4 months. These are chronic conditions. Almost every patient that comes in is a chronic pain. 41% are first contact. So like I was saying, we're kind of primary care, kind of tertiary care in the hospital. We're getting lots of referrals from the orthopedic surgeons and other medical officers. Thank you very much. 14% HIV and 30% have high blood pressure. So in Shoshone, we've seen 140 patients, 1,030 treatments, 77% female, same statistic. We have a much older population that we're treating. They're older, they're farmers, and if you remember back to Dr. Haldeman's slide about those at the most risk, they are poorer, older women in rural areas. And this seems to be what we're treating. Okay? That's a large part of our practice. 50% are farmers, 81% of primary education or lower. So now I have a lower, again, lower education. Now we have 57% spinal, but you'll see that it's 31% are more extremity. So patients are coming to us sort of for anything in that clinic, not just spinal disorders. 98% have their pain greater than 4 months. So again, these are real chronic conditions that we're dealing with. 14% HIV and 43% high blood pressure. So some of the conditions that we've seen, aortic aneurysms, Blount's disease, diffuse idiopathic skeletal hyperostosis in the spine, the knees, and the feet, which are a little more unusual in the knees and feet, a fractured dens, tuberculosis, kidney infection, idiopathic scoliosis, scoliosis secondary to lumbar hemi vertebra, and also we think scoliosis secondary to cerebral palsy. Paget's, rheumatoid arthritis, stroke secondary to low CD4 count, which I guess a lot of the medical officers are also seeing. Sprengel's deformity, stenosis, degenerative disc disease, degenerative joint disease, and a lot of osteoporosis. We've seen 14 patients with vertebral body compression fractures. Very common problem. So let me take you through some cases to sort of highlight what I've been talking about. This is a 68-year-old female with low back pain for more than 1 year. And from Dr. Roach's slides, you can see she has diffuse idiopathic skeletal hyperostosis with a large hyperostosis off the side of the vertebral bodies. And she had low back pain for more than 1 year. We did soft tissue treatment of the lumbar paraspinals and her hips. After three treatments, she had no pain. She was discharged after three treatments. We did another three just to make sure that all the tissues were normalized. We contacted her just back in March so I could put this up on the slide. She's still essentially pain-free. She only gets a little bit of pain when she does a lot of work. And then it'll last about a day and go away. And most of us probably get a little low back pain when we do a lot of work. So you can see that if you looked at this x-ray, you would probably say, this person, I understand why they have back pain. And some people would decide, well, we can't really treat that. So we're just going to give you pain medication or anti-inflammatories to manage that pain. However, her pain was not from any of what we saw on the x-ray. The x-ray did direct our treatment. We did not do spinal manipulation because that could open a whole can of worms and cause those problems. But the soft tissue treatments, the pain she was actually experiencing was from the soft tissue, not from the spine. Another case, this was a 69-year-old female farmer, 7-year history of right hip pain with occasional radiation in the side of the right leg. It was gradual onset, aggravated by walking long distances, constant pain, 7 out of 10, but she also had occasional bouts of sharp pain, no known relieving factors. She came in walking with a cane. She had a normal neurological. Her hip range of motion was as you would expect with anybody with severe osteoarthritis of her hip. The soft tissue that was tender was the right piriformis, tensor fascia latae, glute medius, bilateral paraspinals of the lumbar spine, all the way down to the sacrum. So we assumed that anybody looking at this would say, well, that's because the hip away. And a lot of times that is the case, and you can't do much about that. But we treated her with soft tissue treatments and gave her a few home hip exercises, strengthening exercises. And after 7 treatments, she was 60% better, 60% less pain. She was no longer using her cane, and she was back to more productive work within her community. We still have to refer her to the orthopedic surgeon because that hip will have to be replaced. It will get worse. But in the meantime, you can see that the pain she was experiencing wasn't all from the hip. We're guessing 40% was, and we were able to get rid of the other 60%. But you can't always assume that what you see on x-ray is actually causing the pain. Okay. And last case, this was a 64-year-old female with 5-year history of chronic low back pain, worse at the end of the day, aggravated by working in the field, sweeping, walking, relieved by painkillers and rest. And again, it makes sense that it would be that the degenerative changes that would be causing that pain. She was a diabetic with high blood pressure, had a normal neurological exam, and her chief complaint was reproduced by digging really deep into that tensor fascia latae trigger. So after one treatment, the patient felt much better and returned to work in the fields to help with the harvest. Again, that was a more recent case, so we don't have a long-term follow-up. But the fact is, a lot of her pain came from that soft tissue. I'm showing you some exceptional cases. These are very rare cases. It does happen. We try with every single patient to try to tease out how much of their pain is coming from the pathology we see on the films, how much of their pain is coming from soft tissue pathology or soft tissue fibrosis. And we work on that to try to find out how much better can we get that patient. But the majority of patients are walking in with chronic low back pain, normal findings on x-ray, normal findings on examination, range of motion, you know, there's pain and flexion, pain and extension, pain and with motion, presenting slow onset, and that patient we can do a lot more with because all of their pain is myofascial rather than just portion of it, and some of it's attributed to what we see on the imaging. So I would like to invite, for anybody who has questions, who would like to see a little bit more of the type of work that we're doing, you're welcome to come and visit us in the clinic and spend time with us and see the type of work that we're doing. If you all have my email address, I don't know if that's a good thing or not, but on the registration form, you all sent your registrations to me. So if you have any other questions, if you'd like to come and hang out with us in the clinic, ask more about anything else related to the spine, you're welcome. Just email me.